Okay, it's the Lou Show. It's the Lou Show. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. It's the Lou Show coming at you on thejefffarriasshow.com or Roots Up Radio. Texas, Dewberry Jam, AM 1670. I want to welcome you to the Lou Show. Thank you very much. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's been a really terrible week for progressives. It's been a terrible week for democracy. So let's get to the news. 1 week ago, about 10,000 people marched against Sheriff Joe Arpaio, marching for immigrant rights, and they marched in front of the county jail in Phoenix as a protest, which was aimed at the sheriff. And there was a small clash between a small group of protesters and police officers about supposedly some anarchists bothered a horse, and the horse charged the anarchists, and the next thing you know, what's on the news is a child is claiming that they got pepper sprayed. By the way, I'm going to continue on with the headlines, but I want you to see above me are the numbers to call. Okay, I'll repeat the numbers, but above me are the numbers 602-275-4130. Or if you're out of the Phoenix area, 1-800-385-1566. Anything I mentioned today in the headlines, anything that anybody mentions today during this program, you are welcome to call up and comment on. Let's continue on with the news. Haitian-born musician Wyclef Jean, is that how I pronounce his name? Defended his charity against questions about its accounting practices as he called for the evacuation of Port-au-Prince at a Monday news conference. I saw that news conference, and yeah, he was very sad. Defending his charity against allegations of impropriety. A new survey suggests that an overwhelming number of Americans do not want Sarah Palin, the former governor of Alaska, to run for president. The Justice Department and the FBI have begun a preliminary investigation into actions by Senator John Ensign, a Republican senator from Nevada, who arranged to provide money and career assistance to the husband of his mistress. And that's what sources familiar with the case said on Tuesday. So Ensign is being investigated. Good. The Obama administration's nominee to head the Transportation Security Administration, Errol Southers, withdrew his name from consideration on Wednesday. Sarah Palin, again, plans to campaign for John McCain in March. Former senator who ran for president, John Edwards, admitted Thursday that he fathered a baby with his mistress, Scott Brown. Now, the Republican senator out of Massachusetts wins the Senate over Martha Coakley, and many read this as an upset of the dissatisfaction of independent voters. So you can also read into this a rejection of the progressive platform. President Obama announced new measures to narrow the size and scope of banks' investment activities. He did this on Thursday. President Obama also completed one full year in office and will be delivering the State of the Union address on January 27th. That's next Wednesday. Bob McDonnell, the new Republican governor of Virginia, will deliver the GOP response to Obama's State of the Union address. A manufacturer that has been inscribing Bible references on rifle sights used by U.S. troops in Iraq and Afghanistan announced Thursday that it will stop putting scripture references on products that the U.S. military uses. Cindy McCain, John McCain's current wife, posed for a website promoting same-sex marriage. Good for you, Cindy. I'm rather happy for you that you did that. Yeah. Okay. A 42-year-old Taiwanese man with a history of high blood pressure died of a stroke likely triggered by overexcitement from watching the blockbuster Avatar in 3D. The National Enquirer is seeking a Pulitzer for their investigation into Senator John Edwards, as he recently admitted to be the father of his mistress's baby. The trial of Scott Roeder, the self-confessed killer of abortion provider Dr. George Tiller, began this last week in Wichita, Kansas, on the day, the very day of the 37th anniversary of Roe v. Wade, the U.S. Supreme Court's decision that legalized abortion in the first place. Conan O'Brien agreed to leave The Tonight Show for almost $33 million. That's what he's going to pocket. His producer will get about $4.5 million, and the 200 staff members will split $7.5 million. It's about $37,000 apiece. Total take is about $45 million. We're still in the newsroom, aren't we? Thank you. Burger King plans beer-selling Whopper Bar in South Beach, Florida. Oh, boy. Yeah, I like a beer and a Whopper with that. An all-whites only basketball league is being planned for Augusta, Georgia. Last night, there was a telethon for the victims of the earthquake in Haiti, which raised anywhere between $9 and $16 million. The telethon was put on by actor George Clooney. And finally, what makes this such a terrible week for democracy and progressives, both, is that the U.S. Supreme Court decided to grant corporations the right to spend as much as they like into the pockets of whatever politicians suit their agenda. That's the headlines, and you're welcome to respond by calling 602-275-4130 or 1-800-385-1566. Right now, though, let's hear this.
How do you know you can't write? Have you ever tried? Have you ever attempted even the least bit of training under competent guidance? Or are you have been sitting back? Are it is so easy to be waiting for day to come some when you will waken then.
What if it ain't
all
like
to the discovery sudden? I are a writer. If the latter course is the one of your choosing, you most never will law clerks be, probably. Doctors must interns be. We all know that in our times, chicken eggs does come before chicken. It is seldom that anyone comes writer until he writing for some authors and writers spring out of newspaper dism. Famous writer's school, we have prepared a unique writing aptitude test. This are telling you whether you are possessing fundamental necessaries, quality to successful writing. Acute observation, instinct, dramatic, creative. Observation, you'll enjoy taking this test. The coupon will bring with it, without obligation, Newspaper Institute of America, 7076 Broadway in New York. Why aren't you not then writing?
Caller on line one, who do we got?
Oops.
Corporations. Many corporations are put out on the street each day due to abuse or neglect from ruthless lawmakers who want to put unfair rules and regulations on them, like not allowing them to overcharge customers, like preventing them from charging fees for the privilege of paying the bill, and worst of all, limiting the amount of money they can give to a political campaign. These cruel and unfair rules and regulations on corporations have got to stop. And so we, at the Rescue of Homeless Corporations Corporation, are asking you to help our homeless corporations by giving generously to our rescue efforts so we can get these corporations back into making America the nation Mussolini always wanted. We would also like to thank the Supreme Court of John Roberts for helping making sure fascism will indeed be the American way. Still, there is so much more to do. Give generously to our corporations, won't you?
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, I'm sorry for that little technical glitch before. What we heard was a commercial for Famous Writers School and a new PSA on adopting a homeless corporation. Please, don't let corporations go homeless. Adopt a corporation today. Okay. This week, President Obama made war on banks.
Good morning, everybody.
Upping the ante in his clash with Wall Street, President Barack Obama is proposing new rules to prevent too big to fail. He's asking Congress to cap the size of the nation's biggest commercial banks and make them leave risky investing to brokerage houses and other entities.
We cannot accept a system in which shareholders make money on these operations if the bank wins, but taxpayers foot the bill if the bank loses.
The move would target the top banks at the heart of the financial meltdown and bailout: Citigroup, Bank of America, and Goldman Sachs.
Before it really does anything to banks other than change their stock prices today, it has to get past Congress and the Senate. Whether that will happen is not clear.
But if there's a lesson the White House draws from Tuesday's GOP upset in the Massachusetts Senate race, it's that voters are angry, and lots of the ire's aimed at a bailed-out Wall Street again paying huge bonuses.
If these folks want a fight, it's a fight I'm ready to have. And my resolve is only strengthened when I see a return to old practices at some of the very firms fighting reform.
Administration officials say tightening the rules on big banks was always going to play a major role in the president's second-year agenda. But given the anger expressed by voters in Massachusetts, strategists here reckon having Obama take more swings at Wall Street is an idea whose political time has come. Mark Smith, The Associated Press, The White House.
Okay. All right. Thank you, President Obama. Looks like President Obama means business. He means business, and it turns out that the banks need to do banking, and the investment houses need to do just investment housing. And that way, we won't have a bleed over, and they'll be in the process of making money in their own way. Because the way we got mixed up in this, ladies and gentlemen, is by taking a mortgage and splitting it into a million pieces and selling it overseas. So it's not like the person who couldn't make the payments, who lost their job, could appeal to any central entity for a little more time. That's why the government had to get involved. You know, even the bankers themselves admitted wrongdoing. They were called up in front of Congress, and they said, "Yep, well, we made a mistake. Yep, we sure did." Let's see what. Yeah, I can't find what I'm looking for. Are there new banking laws? Let's find out. And you know, I would again invite you to call up, because other than that, it's just me and the crickets here, and I'm making friends with one specific cricket. You hear it? This is my friend Cricket here. We're making friends. So I'm just waiting for that phone to ring. It's 602-275-4130, 1-800-385-1566. And so, what did CBS News report about the new banking laws?
A week after proposing a bank tax, President Obama called for new regulations for Wall Street that would limit both the size of big banks and their abilities to make high-risk trades.
Never again will the American taxpayer be held hostage by a bank that is too big to fail.
The president's new restrictions would prevent the further consolidation of the financial system. They'd prohibit banks from owning hedge funds, private equity funds, or from using their own capital to make bets on the market.
It's designed to reduce the risky activities being undertaken by banks, since banks have this explicit support from the taxpayer.
But critics said the proposal wasn't attacking the real source of the financial crisis.
The institutions that created this are either gone or not covered by this law. AIG, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac.
But the president stepped up his war of words with Wall Street.
If these folks want a fight, it's a fight I'm ready to have.
The timing, just after the Democrats' defeat in the Massachusetts Senate race, apparently an attempt to tap into public outrage over bank bailouts and big bonuses. Goldman Sachs said today it paid out more than $16 billion in bonuses and compensation for 2009, an average of nearly $500,000 per employee. Morgan Stanley lost nearly $1 billion last year, but will pay out more than $14 billion in bonuses and compensation.
The regulations, if passed, and that's a big if, would mean major banks like Citigroup, JP Morgan Chase, and Goldman Sachs would be forced to get smaller. Wall Street was not enthusiastic about this plan. The Dow lost more than 200 points.
And what gives Obama his cojones for saying, you know, we're going to come up with new banking regulations, so we're going after the banks? What gives him his justification? Well, I heard Obama say it's a contradiction for the government to bail out these large corporations that are too big to fail, yet we see them giving out lots of bonuses. So there's a contradiction there, folks. For crying out loud, if we're going to bail out any company, there should be no bonuses whatsoever. I would dare any banker to give me a call right now and justify their bonus. What is it, because you Christmas came last year and you had to buy your daughter a pony? Oh, come on. Give me a break. So that's right. Folks, we're going to get into some more issues here, and you are welcome to call. And I would really like to get into the issue of the Supreme Court and what made them decide that corporations can spend as much money as they like on a political campaign. Oh, someone's calling. Hello, who is it?
Hi, Lou, it's Tom. How you doing?
Hello, Tom from Scottsdale. Yay! Thank you for calling, Tom. What's up?
Yeah, I wanted to comment on what you were just saying. You know, I think the biggest mistake, if we could put our finger on one mistake that the president has made that is common to almost all of these issues that he's now dealing with, it is that he basically decided to, quote, move on rather than hold the Bush administration accountable. Because he failed to draw that line in the sand, because he failed to hold them accountable and do any investigations, and I realize most of those have to come from Congress, but he is our leader, okay?
Yes.
Because he failed to do that, he is now being, they are now spinning everything that the Bush administration has done into being his fault, okay? I think he's made a number of mistakes along the way. I think he squandered a very, the base of popular support that he had. I don't know if he can recover it. But that, to me, is probably the biggest issue. If he would have held them accountable, held the financial powers accountable, not gone with the same old people in his administration, I think he would have done much better and would be doing much better right now.
Yeah, I think he's I think he's relying on the old human adage that if you leave something alone, that people will come around to their senses and maybe they'll apologize and do the right thing in private. But in front of a large group of people, they have to beat on their chest and still go after the president and maintain their staunch stature. I mean, why do you think he's going on instead of holding firm? Is it because he wants to go on, or is it because he doesn't know how or cannot hold firm?
I think because the advice he is getting is absolutely horrendous. I think that once he became president, he has essentially insulated himself from the rest of society. That's, you know, that's part of being a president. You are going to be isolated because of security reasons, but I think the advice he's getting from his inner circle is absolutely horrendous. I think Rahm Emanuel is responsible for a lot of the mistakes that he's making. I think that, you know, the advice he's getting from the financial side...
Well, let's talk about the financial side there for just a moment. Are you aware that Bernanke, who is up for confirmation is another term for the Fed chief, may not get it?
Yeah, I understand that, but that, that mainly falls out of the Massachusetts vote. You know, they're running scared right now, and I'm an advocate for... contacting all of the representatives now and letting them know they're not being progressive enough, in my opinion, and many of people's opinions. They are not benefiting the common person. Yet the Republicans are spinning this as though they are the party of the common man. Oh, my God. Check out history and see how much truth there is to that. Every election, they're the party of the common man, and then as soon as they get into power, forget about it. They don't do a thing for us. They side with their corporate masters. And, I could go on and on about that. But the reason I was calling is that I think that the biggest issue here is that Obama did not draw that line in the sand. There is not a clear demarcation between the prior administration and his administration. And now the very people who were responsible for the failures of the last administration are now painting it as though it was his failures. And I think it was a completely stupid move on his part. I would say that to him. Were I able to speak to him personally, not that I ever harbor a hope I could, but I would just tell him that that is not the way to move forward. You have to have a demarcation there. You have to show the differences between what the prior party is doing and what you're doing. Now, my advice for him now,
yes.
And not that he's listening to me, but I do send. I'm one of the 40,000 emailers every day. I send him an email. He says he gets 40,000 a day. I always put the header in. Here's 40,001. Okay, but my advice for him is, you know, act as though this is his last 2 days of presidency or his last week in office. If he does not do that, if he does not take on that sense of urgency that he spoke of previously when he was running for president. He is going to get hammered again and again and again.
He's just being too cool, you know? I mean,
he's just being too casual. You know, if this were, if he were following, say, the Clinton administration, this would be a proper approach, you know, because we had a surplus. Things were in pretty good shape. He probably would have. I think he's done a fairly decent job of security. One of the things that never gets mentioned is the Somali pirates that grabbed that boat and the captain and the rescue that was done there. I think that that was a completely appropriate approach. You never hear any more talk about that. What you hear about is the quote Christmas Day bomber who was let onto a plane by a foreign government. That was our security forces.
Tom, you know that people don't bring up positive actions so much. They're, what makes news is negative information, how people make mistakes. You know, the American public, the viewers of media just eat this stuff up, you know, and I'll admit it, I'm one of them too. I scan the tubes and I'm looking for news to see what kind of mistakes people made. And I'll admit, for a long time now, whenever I hear about the Republicans claiming a mistake, I scoff.
Yes, yes. Yeah, I understand. I lean negatively too. I'm a trained engineer. We look for failure. Engineers are trained to look for failure.
What happens when you find perfection?
Are you talking about a personal level or when I'm designing something?
No, let's say, look, I used to be in the aerospace business too. And so what if you come across a piece that is perfect? I mean, I guess it advances.
Save that for future reference.
A great example of that,
I don't want to get too far afield here, but, you know, the architecture of Frank Lloyd Wright, for example, you see the beauty of what that man accomplished, and that is used over and over and over again by future architects. So, you know, there is a place for perfection in the world. Were this a better day, I'd probably be spending more time on it. But we're in dire straits here.
If you're talking standards, and if you're talking Obama is not standing his ground, I'll say he's a little too casual. You know, Lyndon Baines Johnson, I expected LBJ to be casual at a barbecue. But in the Senate, You know, he was one of the strongest strong arms there ever was.
Yes.
Okay, in the Senate and as a president, he kept all those contacts and still utilized that to get things done. Now, let me ask you a question.
Sure.
Should we accept any kind of, this is almost a trick question, should we accept any kind of health care bill as a concession of getting something done, or should we just scrap the whole thing and start fresh?
I think this bill is highly flawed. I don't think this is the bill that the president needs to pass. I don't think checking the box is worth what it will cost. I think what he should do is move forward. I think his congressional and Senate supporters need to start challenging the Republicans. What they need to do is they need to break this bill up into pieces and basically go after pre-existing conditions, go after health care for all, go after these things individually, and make Republicans do an up or down vote on each one of these. See if they can defend themselves against not getting rid of pre-existing conditions.
Well, should we continue on with this issue because we've been doing this issue for 6-8 months, or should we go on to another issue? Because I think the next big issue will be the financial sector.
Yeah, I'm going to use Obama's own words against him. You know, a president's got to be able to do more than one thing at one time. And so I think he needs to do both. I think that this bill is so highly flawed, I think we need to take a different approach. I think that we've gotten so close with this process that we don't want to lose that momentum and completely scrap it, because all that will do is feed the Republicans opportunities to go back and say, hey, you know, they squandered what they could have been doing for the financial sector and putting money in your pockets and helping the economy. What were they doing? They were working on this stupid health care bill. They'll completely push aside the fact that they stood in the way every step of the way. Now, Obama's issue, or Obama's failure there, was that he kept trying to be bipartisan. This was not the time for a bipartisan president. This is a time for a president to take the lead, okay? And there's still perhaps, nowhere near the opportunity there was at the beginning of his presidency, but there's still an opportunity now for him to take that lead and to move forward. As I said earlier, he's got to act like this is the last week of his presidency or the last month. He's got to start acting in that manner. He's got to be urgent. He's got to get things done. He's got to start a government jobs program. The Republicans are going to hammer him no matter what, so he has to do what's right.
I agree. It's time to fish or cut bait. Yes?
No, that was it. That's basically all I had to say. You don't want to get me started on corporations or persons, because I'll go on for another 20 minutes.
Well, Tom, I'll tell you something. I'll also be hosting a Roman show starting from 3 o'clock today, okay, from 3 to 5, and you'll get a chance to call back in, because I am going to be playing some things about the Supreme Court's decision. And now, here's Jeff to tell us what's coming up in 30 minutes on his show.
Thanks.
Thank you, Tom. And now, here's Jeff to tell you what he's doing on his show in 30 minutes.
Thank you, Tom. Thanks for calling in. Always good to hear from you. Well, obviously, the big stories for me this week were the Supreme Court ruling, the ongoing struggles to recover in Haiti, and...
Okay.
I also spoke with a fellow by the name of Professor Francis Boyle, who has filed charges with the International Criminal Court against the key members of the Bush administration for crimes against humanity for their rendition program. This man is a very serious international law human rights attorney, has personal relationships with the prosecutor there at The Hague. And so I'll be sharing the interview I did with Francis Boyle, a conversation I had with Melinda Miles, who works is down there in Haiti, working on the ground at a relief group that she founded in Jacmel, Haiti. We're able to hear, you know, what's happening there down on the ground in Haiti, and giving you an outlet with which to react to it. Also, we spoke with Jeff Milchen from RebuildDemocracy.org about this coalition of all these folks who were coming together to protest the Supreme Court decision giving corporations absolute control of our government. So,
that sounds like one jam-packed 60-minute show.
It sure is. It's almost too much information for 60 minutes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jeff. And, yes, I want to thank Tom for calling in. I'm kind of new at this radio gig, so I forgot to thank Tom for calling in. Tom, I know you're listening, and I always appreciate your phone call. But keep it in with what you had to say about Obama and his approval rating. Let's hear what John Stewart said this week about his approval rating, because as you know, Obama's approval rating is down. But how do you measure that?
The one-year anniversary of the Obama presidency. Obviously, it's hard to fully evaluate the complexities and nuances of the entire substance of our president's first year in the brief time we have allotted. To do so would be reductionist and a disservice to analytical discourse. I think my colleagues in the news media would agree.
Bring it!
What's the overall grade?
All right, overall, I'd give him a B.
I would give him a, you know, D plus, perhaps.
I gave him a B.
I did a B.
Oh, I gave him a D.
We're showing the report card F, so I don't think there's a worse grade, maybe F minus.
There must be some objective measure that is equally reductionist, but based on math.
Our new ABC News Washington Post poll, it finds President Obama with his lowest approval rating yet. 50% approve of his performance in office. That's a steep drop from February, when his approval rating stood at 68%.
Thank you, poll numbers. How did Obama drop 18 points in a single year? Well, it can really best be explained by this simple equation. Basically, you had Gitmo. He lost points when he tried to close it, doubled the loss when he failed. Minus don't ask, don't tell. Two trips to Copenhagen divided by bupkis, which is what he got from those trips. A lot of people say you can't divide by bupkis, but they're wrong. Now you got to subtract the Nobel Prize. I know, it's a great honor for the president and the country. Somehow it's a minus. I don't know how that works. You got to minus the Henry Louis Gates fallout. This is where it gets a little tricky. If you remember high school algebra, it's pettiness raised to the power of class, raised to the power of race, times three beers, divided by siding with a black professor against a cop in Boston, times 10% unemployment, and finally subtract the political capital he spent on a health care initiative, only to have it derailed by a Cosmo centerfold pinup. Add it all up! Negative 24 points. Thank God for Bo, the Portuguese water dog. Without those 6 points, Obama would be screwed.
Yeah, if it wasn't for that water dog, Obama would be screwed. Well, yeah, how do you measure that? Who's taking this poll? Polls can lie. So, you know, we'll return in a few minutes. We're going to take a listen to one of my favorite songs by George Harrison. I wonder where people are. Where are people? How come you're not calling, for crying out loud? Come on, this is the Lou Show. Call 602-275-4130 or 1-800-385-1566. How about you people in Louisville, Kentucky, listening on WXBH, FM 92.7, Dubray Jam, AM 1670.
What I feel, I can't say. Tell me why.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Oh. Hello.
Hello, Lou?
Hello. Oh,
Lou?
It's Jeff.
Lou, this is Jeff in Maricopa.
Uh-huh.
Hey, I just want to let you know, hey, I'm really sorry I missed the first half of the show.
Oh.
Yeah, you are going to post it in your downloads, right?
Yes, as a matter of fact, everybody, I want you to hear this, is that if you go to thejefferrieshow.com, there's a link to there's a link to podcasts, okay? And also on thejefferrieshow.com, on the community board, are all my comedy calls, for which I'll probably get a chance to play a few of them coming up between 3 and 5. But, yeah, there will be a podcast coming up, yeah. And
oh, you're doing Roman's show today, right?
I'm doing Roman's show today.
Oh, cool. Okay, great.
So what's up?
Good. I get to listen to you while I'm doing chores.
Da-da-da-da-da-da. What's on your mind, man?
Hey, well, first of all, as I say, I want to apologize for being late. I was enjoying the fruits of the, or lack thereof, the Pinal County road system. yes.
All right, for those of
believe
you
it
know,
or not, believe, I had to run up to Maricopa, and unfortunately, roads are washed out.
Well, for those of you who don't know, Jeff from Maricopa, and when we call him Jeff from Maricopa, that's who he is, and that's where he's from. He's not in the city proper. He's down in Maricopa, and we just had some rains. All the weather system that came out from California hit Arizona over a 2-3 day period. What have you seen, and how difficult has it been to get around?
Well, it depends. Going up to Maricopa, it's terrible. They give you detours, and the roads are washed out, and people, some of the smaller cars are bottomed out. And they're still sitting there waiting to be towed out. And me, I was driving my truck, so I could have made it through. But the rest of these idiots, you know, if I was driving my Prius, I would be screwed. You know, would have been flooded out. But anyway, so I had to take a detour. It cost me an extra half an hour, and so that's why I missed the first half of the show. And I'm really sorry.
Oh, that's...
it's just you see, you know, I understand now. I live in a very heavily Republican area.
Heavily Republican. I think last week when you called, you termed it a bedroom community, for which I didn't know what that meant.
That's Maricopa. That's different. No, I actually live, you know, what is the county? It is America. It is the Maricopa post office box, but that's about it. Or zip code. Okay?
Okay.
Okay. Anyway, but the area that I live in is very rural. The smallest lot around here is about a third, about 3 1/3 acres.
It's very rural?
Yeah.
Well, there's a guy here.
It's old farmland.
There's a guy here who wants to talk to you.
What?
Hi. Hi, this is Hitch. Hey, is this Jeff? Hello?
Yes. Hello, who's this?
Hello, this is Hitch. Hey, I understand it's quite rural out there. How rural do you mean?
How rural?
Yeah, what do you mean by rural?
I live on a dirt road.
A dirt road? You think my donkey can make it through your dirt road?
Barely.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what. Maybe I'll consider moving to... what was that again? Where was that again?
Actually, it's a place called Saddleback Farms.
Oh, Saddleback Farms. Sounds like Doubleback Alley.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, okay. Well, hey, I'll let you talk to Lou again, okay?
Okay, thanks.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Okay, tell me more.
Okay, well, anyway, no, I was just going to say that, living in a heavily Republican area, I've learned that Republicans look at government different than progressives. We look at government as an instrument for good. Republicans look at government as the enemy.
They see it as the enemy. And I'll tell you what, I was doing some reading. Ross Perot came out. Remember when it was Clinton, Perot, and the first Bush? It was 92, yep. And that's what Ross Perot relied on, were all the independents. Earlier, when Tom called, he said, you know, Obama is going to lose the progressives, but it's all the independents in the middle, all the people in the middle that shift from one side to the other. And he's right. If the Democrats, if Obama and his administration can't deliver something, you know, by 2012, 2011, all those independents are going to shift over. So I guess all the people in Maricopa will be real happy.
Well, it's a little bit different. You know, Maricopa, you actually got to drive through there sometime to understand it, or look at, you know, maybe they got a web page.
But the point is, I understand
why a lot of these people down here don't like government, because the only government, the most obvious government that they see is the county government, which is just a joke.
The county government
it's
is
just
a joke.
Pathetic. They don't maintain the roads. It's corrupt as all get out, and it's just you know, we've got a sheriff here that is a wannabe Joe Arpaio.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's the same thing. So anyway.
Oh.
Anyway, it's just very disappointing. So, but hey, I wanted to call and ask
you,
did you happen to mention that today was the day in 1719?
In 1719?
Liechtenstein was created by the Holy Roman Empire?
Liechtenstein was created by the Holy Roman Empire! Yeah!
I mean, you didn't mention it.
No, I didn't mention it.
You swine. Well, you unconscionable swine.
I'm a swine, you know.
Well, Liechtenstein, we don't think too much about it. It's like the second or third smallest country in the world.
Liechtenstein.
Not a whole lot of famous Liechtensteiners. There are only two that really come to mind. One is Hanni Müller. Hanni Müller, who was a downhill skier who won the women's gold medal. Winter Olympics, and I think it was 1980, if I'm not mistaken.
It's the only time we ever hear about Liechtenstein, I guess, is during the Olympics.
Yeah. There's another. The other one, famous Liechtensteiner, is Ulrich von Stupen. Von Stupen. Ulrich von Stupen. And he is the proprietor of the House of Ulrich 24-hour laundry. Very famous all around the world. I got to put in a plug for this guy. I mean,
and
like
Chinese Emporium,
successful laundry. I mean, man, if you got dirty money, he'll get it clean for you. No muss, no fuss.
Uh huh. Starch is extra.
It's you know, I mean, world renowned. I mean, you know, they really encourage you to take part in their paperless billing. It not only saves you money, but jail time.
You remember what was that movie Office Space where they figured out that if they just shave off 0.00123 pennies per dollar that, you know, it'll just be a little bit of money, but then they gathered millions of dollars overnight. Remember that?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Well, but I really wish anybody who wishes to avoid paying taxes, and if you've engaged in a an illegal enterprise, you might want to look up Ulrich. No, I'm pronouncing it wrong. It's Ulrich.
Ulrich Stupen.
Ulrich von Stupen.
Oh, Stupen. That's past
Ulrich,
tense.
You know, it's Ulrich mit Umlaut. Those two stupid dots over the U.
Uh huh.
You ever tried saying that word with a Umlaut?
I'm really Umlaut. I'm really not a language.
But there's a trick to it. I mean, like, you have to. It evokes your gag response. You know, like, it's almost like, you know, I remember, you know, my stepmother's shepherd's pie, you know, like, you know, when I was trying to expel it after, you know, she gave it to us, it'd be like leaning over the toilet going, ooh, no.
I want to thank you for calling. You know, I tell you, but it was that call about Stupen that kind of
von Stupen.
Von Stupen that watch out for that von Stupen business, you know. Anyway, so look.
Happy Liechtenstein birthday to you.
Liechtenstein birthday. I want to thank you for calling. Okay,
hey, you're quite welcome, Luke.
Okay.
All right. Take
care. Oh, hello.
Hello.
Hello. What's the matter there? Have you got a cold? Who is this?
No, this is guess who this is. Take a wild guess.
I think I know who it is, but I you have to give me more.
Wayback machine. Go in the Wayback machine.
The Wayback machine.
I don't sound like myself.
Okay, let me get into the Wayback machine here. It's Mercedes from Mesa.
Yes, it is, and I'm starting to get my voice back.
Oh.
That's why you guys haven't heard from me in a while.
I wonder, whatever happened to you? How's school?
I did great. I have a 3.67 grade point average.
Well, that's marvelous. I want to applaud for you. Yay!
Thank you.
Yay! Yay, yay, yay! Now, Mercedes, I know you've been studying farming, agriculture.
Actually, this semester, I'm starting my first ag class.
Okay. But can you tell us a few things about the evil Monsanto Corporation and what they're likely to do now that the Supreme Court has lifted any barriers from corporations? I mean, have you thought of this? I'm sure you're
oh, yeah, yeah, definitely.
I know, and you then, take a look at the business side of things in this regard.
In fact, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to go around the Internet and find a couple of documentaries for people to watch. Coincidentally, I'm AZ Gecko, and I will be putting right. up some stuff up there on a genetically modified food.
Okay.
And what Monsanto is doing to these seeds, what they're doing is they're buying up small seed companies. All right. And they are genetically changing the seeds. So you plant the seed, and whatever comes up, if it has seeds, those seeds will not reproduce. Or if they do reproduce, it will be mutated. There are a lot of people in biotech that want to tell you, oh, that there's no problem. The thing is that the body, like the biosphere, is a very, very intricate system, simply because it mimics, whatever they engineer mimics the original. Doesn't mean that your body is going to be able to synthesize it, be able to use it, be able to pull in the nutrients. I don't care what these science majors tell you.
Could we be at risk for eating some of this food? I mean, is the
yes,
food...
you already are. For instance, I don't remember if I heard it on Jeff's program, because I've been taking in a lot of information lately. But in Haiti, one of the reasons why Haiti is so poor, and this is going to piss a lot of people off.
Okay, let's
piss
them
off. Reagan and Clinton administration's trade policies. They basically put a gun to Haiti's head and told them, you are going to import rice instead of produce your own rice. The rice that they are importing is genetically modified. It's genetically modified.
And it cannot reproduce.
And not only that, I don't think they can even grow it there. And they've also forced Haiti to get rid of their indigenous pigs. Okay, the ones that could drink the water that they have on the island.
Right.
That, okay, the pigs already had their immune systems that could deal with the water.
With the indigenous bacteria.
Bacteria and all yeah. that. And they forced the people of Haiti, the farmers, to import pigs from Iowa that needed water like we have here in the U.S., the purity standard, all right, which has basically put a lot of the farmers, or even the average family in a position where they can't raise pigs anymore. There goes their protein. All right. All of the food now that they used to be able to produce there, they now can't produce anything. You may be living in a grass hut, but at least you could eat. Now they could hardly do that.
Oh, man.
Because of these stupid trade policies. That's why I'm telling people, and again, I know you guys haven't heard me in a long time.
Well, that's good to hear from you.
You probably don't recognize me.
No, I recognize you, Mercedes.
Start raising a victory garden. I don't care if it's just one stinking tomato plant or some beans or just lettuce. There's plenty of information out there on the Internet where you could get seeds that are not Monsanto touched. Okay, you have to do your research and find out which seed companies are owned or doing business with Monsanto.
Is that the
All
next
right?
thing Monsanto is going to be going after, more of those independent seed companies, do you think?
And that's why You guys have to get a hold of somebody from Phoenix Permaculture Guild. All right? People are trading seeds. We're trading seeds. All right? There's also, and right now it escapes me, there's organization here local to Arizona and I think also to New Mexico that have indigenous seeds in, you know, stuff that grows naturally here in Arizona. Get involved with harvesting mesquite pods. Mesquite pods, those things that you think are a nuisance, start collecting them away from trees that are not by main traffic thoroughfares,
and keep them away from Monsanto.
Okay, because here's what you could do. There's in the fall, through the Phoenix Permaculture Guild, they collect all those pods, and those pods can be milled into usable flour. Mesquite flour is very high in protein,
yes.
Okay, and has a low glycemic index. That means it's really good for people that have, like, diabetes. They can eat this, and it's not going to spike their blood sugar like regular white flour or cornmeal.
Well,
would.
I will admit, eating indigenous food will only make you stronger for living in the indigenous area.
Exactly, exactly. And also, a lot of the cacti, all right, like in Mexico, nopales, those are if I remember correctly, it's the prickly pear cactus pad, the pad. All right, you can eat the prickly pear. It's really good for you. There's a lot of vitamins and nutrients, and also, and it also helps your body acclimate to the extreme heat, and helps you hold in the necessary water. All right,
Mercedes. Uh huh. Go ahead.
And you know, nopales, the cactus itself, it can be cooked, and it's also a very excellent source of nutrition. You know, we have to get back to being independent and get away from these multinational grocery stores that are selling us crap and poison.
No kidding, no kidding. Hey, I got a question for you. You talk about plants, but what about chickens?
In Phoenix, you're allowed, if I'm not mistaken, I think, depending on the size of your lot, you're allowed to have two chickens. You do not need a rooster in order for chickens to produce eggs. You can feed your chickens.
You don't?
You can feed your chickens table scraps. When you buy your produce, the ugly leaves on the outside or the potato peelings, they'll eat all that.
They'll eat anything? Chickens?
Pretty much.
Wow.
Pretty much.
Wow. Oh, so tell me, what do you think about cows?
You're better off for in this area, goats.
Goats. Well, when I was a kid.
Goats. And I'm going to tell you why.
Okay.
Because goats have excellent meat, and if you pick the proper animal, the proper breed, if you want it for milk, goat's milk.
Right.
Is more digestible for humans than cow's milk.
Well, when I was a kid, I couldn't drink regular milk. My mother had to go and get goat's milk.
Exactly.
It was a
exactly.
specialty
and it's,
back
it's,
then.
And it's actually better for you because you know that they haven't messed with goats yet because most people turn their noses up at goats.
I want you to All eat right. what has not been messed with yet.
Exactly. Uh-huh. Because that's why people are getting sick.
Yes.
That's why people are getting sick.
I suppose I should change to goat's milk or do something different because I've got this sinus infection here that just won't go away. Do you think it's related to food?
Yes. Yes, and I'm pretty sure this thing with my voice
uh-huh.
is related to food because since I've started cleaning up my diet and staying away from processed dairy, you know, mainly cow's milk, it produces excess mucus. And it's that thick, pasty crap that lingers on in your sinuses and in your throat. That's why I'm sounding this way.
Okay,
I still have the residue from that.
Well, let me get this straight. You say stay away from processed crapola. Okay? And
yes. Big corporate farming, anything, if at all possible, reduce as much as you can of anything produced by big farm corporations.
Okay.
Did I throw you off there?
Yeah, you did. I expected something else to go on, but instead I was thrown off, and I was just thinking, where is my head? You know, I'll tell you something, Mercedes. We're getting to the end of the program, but I would invite you to listen for the rest of the day. I'll be subbing for Roman and Liz on America at Work. And this, okay, so thank you very much for calling. I was thinking about you the other day. So I wonder, where is Asgecko, Mercedes, and Mesa? And now we found her. So I want to thank you.
I'm getting my voice back, yes.
Thank you. And, you know, you got to call in a little more often.
Now that I have my voice, I will.
Okay, very good. Thank you for calling. Call again. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we're reaching the end of our show. I tell you, the hour just flew by, but I'm wondering, where are all the callers that I thought would be calling in today? Where's Joe from Tempe? Where's Mike from Scottsdale? Where are all my friends from back home? How about all these people? Well, let's just conclude our day. And I'll see you in an hour. I want to thank you very much for listening to The Lou Show on thejefferriasshow.com, on WXBH 92.7, and on Dewberry Jam 8 AM 1670. The Lou Show is a product of the Jeff Ferriasshow.com studios. Thank you. See you in an hour.